what we see here is basically a Camunda Cloud console. It's our management interface where you can create clusters, where you can also already model diagrams, etc. And I already created one cluster for me for playing for this session. It has the Zeebe Alpha 6 version currently running. And if you look into it, you also see we have now operate and task list inside that cluster running. And what I want to do now is basically model a really small sample process and to show off this project and all the features with it. And this first project process will just do one thing. It will check for if a number is a prime number. For that, we will just add like a small service task to the process. And the service task will have like a name, check prime number. And as in Zeebe, everything is like an external task. As you know from Camunda BPM, we also have to give it a type. So later a task worker or job worker can basically subscribe to that and pick it up. Now I just deployed it to my cluster and I can also immediately from the modeler create a new instance. And as you see in the bottom, there's like now an instance created, which we can check out and operate and see the current state of the instance. And as expected, the instance is now waiting in my service task. And there's nothing going on because basically we didn't implement it yet, the business logic of that service task. So as the next step, I want to implement that business logic. So first I copy the type of the service task and I prepared a small sample project. It's just an empty Spring Boot project. As the first thing, we can add the Zeebe Spring Starter dependencies, so we can actually connect with the cluster. And that allows us to annotate our Spring application when we have the dependency exactly with enable Zeebe client. And this way I can now basically write code which directly interacts with my Zeebe engine. For now, we want to implement the Zeebe worker, so I can basically specify the type. I can also specify other parameters. For example, a timeout. A timeout would basically mean if I don't finish my task after 10 seconds, another Zeebe worker could take over the task. So it's kind of a lock timeout. The method itself gets two parameters. The first one is basically the job client. This job client allows me to interact with the Zeebe workflow engine, and I get, of course, the job which I'm currently working on. As a first step, we can just complete the job to see that it works. For that, we have to specify the key of the job we want to complete, and we have to send the command to Zeebe. Let's also add a small logger so we can actually see that something happens in our demo. Give me a second. So now we can just log that we completed the job and of which type it is and which key it has, for example. So this is now our business logic. What we now have to do is basically we have to configure our client that we actually can connect to the cloud instance I just created. For that, we have to specify three things. It's the cluster ID, which is the identifier of the cluster, the client ID and the client secret, which is basically credentials for this Zeebe client. And to do that, we can go back to the console and basically in our cluster view, we can copy the cluster ID and paste it into our application YAML. And then we can go again to the console and create a new client credential for this demo, which basically gives us a client ID, which we can copy, and the client secret. And that's all I need to now connect my local worker with the cloud instance. So if I now run the application, we should actually be able to complete our first job. Let's see if it works. Okay, when we look at the logs, we can see, okay, the job was acquired and it was also completed already. If we now go back to operate, we should see that this workflow instance finished and it happened exactly. So let's now actually build some business logic so our process actually does something. As I said, we want to check for prime numbers. So let's start with defining what is actually the process variables we want to have in our process instance. Therefore, we can actually create a POJO, which just defines these variables, so we can easily work with them in a typed fashion. Let's say we want to have a number as an integer as the input of our process, and then we will return basically a Boolean, which says if that number is a prime number. Is that POJO, what we can now do is basically ask from the job the variables of the process instance, and this in a typed fashion. So we can save them in a variable. And we can also then, for example, set the is prime value based on if the number is actually prime. For this, we will shortly implement that method. Let's see if I remember how to check for prime number. I guess we have to check if it's divisible by anything between 2 and the half of the number. So let's put a small for loop and check if the number is divisible by that value. If so, then this is not a prime number, so we will return false. And otherwise, we will return true because the number is prime. So the last thing we now have to do is basically when we complete the job, we actually have to specify also the variables which now changed. So Zeebe is actually aware of what changed in the process. So if we run that again, everything should compile and we should be able to start a new instance. So let's go back to our diagram and let's create a new instance of the diagram. Again, we can check operate to see what's going on in the instance, and apparently there's a problem. Let us check shortly what is the problem. So apparently the service task failed. If we look at the error message more closely, okay, we see we didn't specify the number variable. So basically our business logic expected that and exploded. So let's fix that problem by setting a value. And let's use 5, which is a prime number. And also let's retry this incident. If we go back to our application, we should see that this was now actually completed already. And if we go back to operate, we should see that the process finished and actually the prime number test also worked because 5 is a prime number. So let's try that again with another number. Let's go again to console and start a new instance. Let's see if our current year is, for example, a prime number. So let's specify the variable number, which is just a JSON object here with 2021. And let's start the instance. And if we now should go to operate, actually that instance should already be finished and it's not a prime number. So that is already the first step. And let's make it a bit more complex. I don't want to check every number one by one. So let's create a second process. And this one should just create like a bunch of random numbers and check if they are prime. Basically it will have 3 tasks. The first task should ask basically a user how many numbers should we generate. So let's call it input number of amount of numbers. The second task will then generate these random numbers. And then the third task will actually check if these numbers are prime. The first one should then be like a user task, so actually a user can input that. The second one will be a service task. Again, we can implement that in our code. Let's give it a type. And the third one will actually be a call activity because we already have that process which actually does that. For that, I now need the process ID, process definition ID. So I will copy that shortly and put it into the call activity. Actually, as we are now generating a list of numbers, we have to do a multi-instance of that call activity because we have multiple instances of it. So let's say we have a list of numbers, which is our input collection, which we then map to the number variable, which is the input for the call activity. And then we will collect the results of the call activity into the prime results, and we take the is prime result. So we also have to map this is prime result from the call activity into the parent process so we can actually collect it. Okay, with that done, the process should be okay. Let's deploy it. And let's also start already an instance of it and check operate how it's looking so far. As expected, again, we are standing in the first task. This is this time a human task, so we will not implement code, but we can actually go to the task list, our user task system. And what we should see is that there's now a user task available. I can claim it. And now I can basically add variables by this user task. So let's call it amount of numbers as variable name, and let's specify 5, for example. When we now complete the task, we should be able, when we go back to operate, to see that it now is waiting in the next service task, and the variable which we just set in the human task or user task is actually available in the process. So let's implement that service task. Again, we can just create a new Zeebe worker in our code with the job type, which we specified here. The method signature is the same again. We get the job client and the job itself. And we can again define basically our process data first. So what are the variables we expect? So let's again define a portal for that. As we defined in the model, we expect that we generate a numbers collection, so like a list of integers. So that's one part, basically our output. And then we also already set the variable in the process, which basically is our input amount of numbers. So also let's add it to the variables. Okay, with that portal, again, we can get our variables from the job itself. And now we can generate the random numbers based on the amount of numbers. We can just use a small int stream over the amount of numbers and map it to a random number. Let's say we put like a bound of 10,000 maybe, box it and put it in a collection. And then we can just copy the code we have in our other Zeebe worker to complete the task. By actually sending the variables and logging that we did something. Okay, let's start that and see if it works. If it works, we should immediately see that there's a new job picked up. So let's check the log. As we see correctly, we acquired a job for the generate random numbers. We generated 5 random numbers. That's why we then acquired 5 jobs for the check prime number. And if we go back to operate, we see now that these are the numbers we generated and all of them are non-prime. So that didn't work that well, but maybe let's try it again. What is the problem here is right now that the user actually has to know what variable to set in the user task, but we can do that better by actually specifying a user task form. So the user doesn't have to know that information. So let's call it amount of numbers. Let's put like a text field, which basically asks the user to enter it. Let's give a bit help to the user so they know what to do here. And then we say that basically our variable is called amount of numbers. So we can actually use it then later in the process. With the form, we can also say that field is required and we can specify, for example, a regular expression to validate that the user only enters valid numbers and inputs into this field. Let's save that form. And if we go back to our diagram, we can now basically go to our user task and select this form as a user task form and deploy the process again. Start a new instance of it then. So if we check operate again we should wait in the first user task. But this time when we go to task list, we actually should see like an input form, which is easy to fill out for the user. So let me claim this task. And now I see my field. I cannot paste strings in it anymore because we have that validation. So I can actually just paste real numbers. So let's try 10 this time. It's completed. Let's go back to operate and see. Okay, we generated 10 random numbers and now basically we are checking them. If we refresh, it should be finished. And this time we had some prime numbers under them. Okay, so that was nice. Let's start another instance of that process. And let's say this time I don't want to only check like 10 instances, but let's make it a bit bigger. So let's go to user task list again, claim the task. And let's say, for example, this time we want to check 500. So let's complete that task. If we now go to operate, oh, I should probably shortly close my local one because otherwise it gets a bit hot here. Then we now try to complete all of these. So let's go to operate and check it. What we have got here, we have one running instance of our main process, but we should have a lot of more of the check prime number. So my computer was actually able to finish some already, but we still have 400 left. So now to do that in a more better way, let's maybe deploy our worker to the cloud. To do that, what we first have to do is basically build a Docker image. We can use here the Zeebe plugin to just build it easily out of our code base. And let me add that dependency. And let's shortly configure which image we want to build here. We can push it to my Docker Hub account. So let's call it mensby/Camunda Community Summit. And let's do this tag as 2021. And when we now build this project with Maven and Zeebe, we can actually create that Docker image automatically. So basically it now compiles it, packages in the small Docker images and pushes it to Docker Hub. And what I already prepared is basically a Kubernetes resource for that deployment. So it's a normal deployment resource. We will use the image I'm currently pushing to the cloud. And we want to have 10 workers. So 10 parallel workers will actually try to finish this 400 tasks. So we can now basically deploy that to Kubernetes. After that, we can check if the pods are already started. It should be fast. One is still missing and now it's done. Okay, let's shortly check the logs of the pods if everything is working as expected. Okay, seems they're doing work. Let's go to operate and refresh the page. And all of them are done. So basically all of them are done. That means my parent process should also be done. Let's drill down in it. We can see now here the variables, the 500 values we generated, the 500 results, and all the activities which were finished in the meantime. So that was basically my demo.